everyone, welcome to the next episode of Proof for Change, an initiative by Green Frontier Capital, one of India's premier climate tech focused VCs. I'm Ritika, I'm a venture analyst at Green Frontier Capital, and I'm happy to host Dr. Ashwin Mahalingam today with us, a professor at IIT Madras, and I'll let him introduce himself and tell us a little bit more about his journey.
Hi, everyone. And first of all, thank you very much, Ritika, for having me on this podcast. So my name is Ashwin Mahalingam, and I'm a professor of civil engineering at IIT Madras. I'm actually from Madras, or Chennai, as we call it now. Studied at IIT Madras, did an undergraduate degree in civil engineering at IITM, and then went abroad, went to the US, spent about 8 years in the United States, about 6 years doing a master's and a PhD at Stanford University, and then a couple of years working in a startup in between my master's and a PhD. I came back to India a little bit more than 15 years ago, and I've been at IIT Madras ever since, teaching, doing research, consulting on projects related to what we call the built environment, which is typically what civil engineers do. And very recently, I've taken upon a new role as the head of our new School of Sustainability at IIT Madras, which I'm sure we'll talk about a little bit later. So that's just a brief background about what I've been doing.
That's wonderful. Your journey has started and has brought you back to IIT Madras. It's always good to know. So since you mentioned that you've lived in the US and studied in the US, there's a lot of academic impact on policy making in the US. How do you see that in India? How do you see the impact of academia on policy making and the general acceptance of academia in the country's policy?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. There are certain areas where a lot of academic input is taken into the larger policy environment, particularly when it comes to things like codes and standards. So very often when you look at things like the Bureau of Indian Standards, you'll find that a lot of these committees are chaired by professors at the IITs or the IISCs or whatever. And therefore, a lot of the research that happens in laboratories in academia then gets translated into codal provisions that you use in practice. But beyond that, actually, in terms of formulating strategy and policy around things like climate change or electric mobility, or even just industries like construction and manufacturing, there's probably not as much scientific input that goes from laboratory-based science into actual policy as compared to a place like the United States. But I think we are sort of on a journey, and given where we were 15 years ago, I see a little bit more of it happening today. And hopefully this will just continue to sort of increase.
I absolutely agree with you. As VCs, we often, when we speak to companies, we realize that there is a policy missing, which also leaves us with some policy risks that we are unsure of. So I think as things get more technical more science is involved in companies, we require strong academia a bit more. So absolutely on that. And since we're talking about sustainability, maybe if you could tell us how you perceive India in the context of the global sustainability. Because we've been hearing a lot about how India is going to be the major turning point for climate change in a lot of ways. So how do you see that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, India is home to, 1.3 odd billion people. And that is a significant chunk of the world's population. And going forward, a lot of the carbon that the world will be emitting will come from places like India and China. We have these statistics where we say only one third of India has been built. We still have to build almost twice in terms of what we already have, whether it's in terms of residences, roads, airports, ports, whatever. And all of that will hugely impact the amount of emissions we're throwing out into the atmosphere. When you have 1.3 billion people consuming things, because of which production has to keep pace, again, you have a huge footprint. So countries like India, I think, are going to be significant players. Historically, our footprints have been lower per capita because the energy intensity of what happens in India is far less than, say, the United States and elsewhere. And hopefully we will keep it that way. But from that perspective, I think India is going to be a key player, which means that to the extent to which we innovate and to the extent to which we bring in ideas and approaches that reduce our water footprint, that reduce our material footprint, that reduce our embodied carbon footprint, this is going to be a huge game changer as far as the world is concerned, just because of the trajectory of growth that India has embarked on and the sheer size of the population that we have.
Absolutely agree with you. And since we're talking about new technologies, I just want to understand from you how you see startups playing a role in it, since new technologies are largely going to be driven by the private sector. Where do you see startups playing a role?
Yeah, so I think startups have a huge role to play. And the reason I say that is, you know, when you talk about innovation, there are typically two kinds of innovation. There's incremental innovation and radical innovation. And sometimes when you're sort of a large established organization, it becomes very difficult to radically innovate because you already have a lot of processes set in place and you can't necessarily upset the apple cart wholesale. There's, of course, a lot of incremental innovation that does take place in large organizations. But to me, radical innovation is possible to a greater extent through startups that are essentially starting out on a clean sheet, you know, questioning existing assumptions and coming out with completely paradigm shifting technologies. So to me, I think, I mean, large organizations are going to continue to innovate and they have the advantage of scale and that's going to be important. But I think a critical part of this puzzle is going to be smaller companies, startups coming up with paradigm shifting innovations. But in many cases, in some cases, I think they may grow on their own. But in other cases, I think they will have to grow in partnership with more established organizations, whether it's as a partner or whether it's you know, larger companies acquiring these technologies. There are many pathways. But to me, without startups, I think the rate at which we innovate is going to be far slower than what it will be if we embrace a much more vibrant startup ecosystem in the sustainability space.
I agree. And since you've spent a very large part of your time at IIT Madras as the head of the entrepreneurship cell, we'd love to hear from you about any radical innovation that you've seen in your time there. Any specific instances that you'd like to recall?
Yeah, sure. So one of our most popular and successful startups that has come out of IIT Madras is the startup called Aether Energy that several of you might have heard of. They are in the electric mobility space. They make electric two-wheelers. And they make electric two-wheelers. It's not that they were the first ones to make electric two-wheelers, but they started off with a promise to make electric two-wheelers that would give you the performance of a regular two-wheeler. So earlier, you used to have these electric two-wheelers that used to have very low pickup speeds, could travel very short distances. They were perfect for a campus like IIT Madras, where you're only traveling a kilometer or two, and you're traveling at relatively slow speeds. But it's not something that you could really use to travel 100 kilometers as you would with other means of transport. So Aether sort of you know, started with that in mind and essentially, in my view, radically rethought the way we need to architect these kinds of two-wheelers. And of course, are they the only ones to do it? No, but they were one of the trendsetters. And it was an interesting example of some amount of work that was done at IIT Madras, which was then productized. And of course, these guys have gone full steam ahead since then. But then having done that, they've actually partnered in this case with Hero Motor Company, which I think has been one of their investors, to actually scale. And I think today they are one of the more successful startups in this space. And their product is absolutely fantastic, both from a design perspective as from a functionality perspective. So that to me is one example of a startup that came through our pipeline that radically rethought the way one aspect of sustainability, electric mobility, should look at, and then partnered with you know, with corporates to actually scale up to what I feel is a reasonably successful juncture today.
That's a very interesting point that you brought up, which is that with radical innovation, you also require the incumbents to change their policies and change their strategy. And I think the example that you gave has been perfect for that. So at your time as the head in charge of the entrepreneurship cell at IIT Madras, what was that one key piece of advice that you gave to the students, founders, who were actually at the brink of something massive?
So I think the key piece of advice that I would give is that technology is the easy part. You know, of course, technology is complicated. I'm not saying it's easy, but it's easier. Given, I mean, if you're a place like IIT, you have those basic technical analytical skills, you know, your understanding of maths and physics and all of that is good. You probably will be able to come up with a technical solution, but to actually get it implemented in practice, to create a market out of a technology is extremely challenging. And so the biggest piece of advice I give people is twofold. One, you have to be persevering, because it's going to be a long journey. And second is you've got to really add on a whole different set of skills in terms of being able to articulate the value proposition of what you're doing long term, in terms of being able to sort of find those selling points so that people actually start looking at this not just as a technological innovation in a lab, but actually as an everyday product that they can use. And to me, I think a lot of entrepreneurs, at least from IIT, sometimes think that once they've figured out the technology, that's it. I mean, the world should just sort of adopt these directly. And unfortunately, it doesn't work that way. So so for any aspiring technopreneur, as we call them, my sort of advice would be certainly focus on the technology. Because if you don't have a technology, you don't have anything. But just because you've solved the technological part, the journey is not over. You're only halfway up the mountain. And there's still another steeper half with lower oxygen levels that you have to climb to get to the peak.
That's a wonderful piece of advice. I really like to appreciate that sentiment. But now that we're talking about IIT Madras and the journey, let's talk a bit more about the School of Sustainability, which is in the news. Everyone's read about it, everyone's heard about it. But maybe if you could tell us at the head, what was the inspiration behind it?
Yeah, so actually a lot of people have asked me that question, and I have to confess that, it's a bit vague because there were many sort of forces that came at us from different directions. One, internally, I think we realized that sustainability is critical, and organizations like IIT Madras, one of the preeminent institutions in India, needs to take the lead for people to listen and sort of change what they're doing. So I think internally, there were professors, for instance, who had emailed our director saying, hey, why don't we start something on sustainability? Externally as well, there were a number of people who were talking to us, our alumni, for instance. You know, we occasionally go to the United States and elsewhere to meet with our alumni to try to sort of see if we can build better linkages. And a lot of them suggested, hey, why don't you guys think about doing something more systematic in terms of sustainability? Corporates asked us this question, what are you guys doing? So we had multiple forces. And at some point, I think we just said, look, let's get something started. So I was asked to, along with a group of about a dozen faculty, put something together. And what we've done is something a little bit different from what you find in other parts of the world. Our School of Sustainability is not a department. It's not a place where we admit people into, they spend a few years and then come out with a degree in sustainability. We've architected our School of Sustainability more as a platform, or as we call it, a center of centers. So the idea is that you can be a student who's studying civil engineering or mechanical engineering or aerospace or whatever it is. But you should be able to use the school to skill yourself on sustainability. So it's one of these. So the notion of being a school and not the department means that anybody in the institute, whether you're doing an undergraduate degree, a master's degree in computer science, in material science, in metallurgy, whatever, should be able to leverage the school, take a set of courses and sort of build capacity in sustainability. So from that perspective, the objectives of the school are threefold. One is clearly IIT Madras has a mandate to build capacity, to build human resources, right? So human resource development is one goal. We want to do it in two ways. One is internally, we will have a series of programs. We are about to launch what we call a minor stream, which means any student on campus can graduate with a major in whatever and a minor in sustainability, and that will be out as early as next year. But we are also going to offer what we call an integrated or interdisciplinary dual degree program, which allows any student to stay back an extra year and get a master's in sustainability, any undergraduate student. And there's a pathway in terms of some basic courses on sustainability that straddle the economic, the environmental, and the social sides of sustainability, as well as some depth in whether it's sort of energy efficiency or water or waste and so on. So there are some pathways that we will make available and students can choose those. But we also realize that, I mean, we have 11,000 students plus or minus on campus today, and we have 1.3 billion people in the country. So just training an IIT Madras student is only going to be a drop in the bucket. We want to start looking at ways in which we can open out our offerings to people who may not have entered into IIT Madras through a competitive exam. So we're in the process of creating a variety of continuing education programs, winter summer schools, as well as online certification and diploma programs that people at large can apply for and skill themselves on. So over a period of time, you'll see a variety of offerings, starting with a minor for our existing students, but then progressing towards online certifications and diplomas and summer schools for practitioners and policymakers. That's one part of it.
Yeah.
Which is on the teaching, training, capacity building, human resource development side. The other part of this is on research. The second part is on sort of research projects and consulting. Here, we already have faculty who are doing research in the area of sustainability. In fact, one of the reasons we developed the school is because you have people in mechanical engineering looking at green supply chains, people in civil engineering looking at net zero buildings, people in environmental engineering looking at water, people in material science looking at urban mining and things like that. And what we want to do as part of the school is to try to bring these people together to start working systemically on problems. So to give you a little bit of an idea, if you start looking at net zero buildings that everyone is talking about, one aspect of net zero buildings is the materials that you use, and you need to sort of use carbon friendly materials. But there is also an aspect of design. Can I design my building so that it minimizes the amount of material that I use? There's also this aspect of, after I built this building, do we have the really good heating, ventilation, air conditioning systems? Have we electrified the building? Things like that, building performance. Now, if you look at it from a disciplinarity perspective, civil engineers work on materials, architects work on design, mechanical and electrical engineers work on your HVAC system. And typically, in a university, they're all spread across departments. And what the School of Sustainability wants to do from a research perspective is to try to bring these people together so that we can start looking at more integrated interdisciplinary research projects, right? And we've got a few areas that we've identified for this. But we're also very clear that we don't want to stop only at scientific publications that go into peer-reviewed journals. We're also looking at technology transfer. Startups could play a role there. Actual project implementation and policy advisory as well, as things that we would like to see come out of our research. And then the third part of the school, which piggybacks onto this whole policy advisory conversation, is more outreach. So can we do things like periodic policy dialogues on various issues related to sustainability, where we bring in entrepreneurs, financiers, policymakers, bureaucrats, academics, practitioners, all to IIT Madras, small groups of people, convene very focused ideas, focused sort of roundtables, based on which you have outputs that actually push the needle forward. So can we be both inward-facing and outward-facing? So we've got a roadmap of things that we want to do. We'll see. I mean, the future, we've just started. We literally launched our school on the 7th of October. So that's less than 3 weeks. But I think the key takeaway from our perspective is this is not something we're doing internally, where we're taking our students and giving them degrees. Yeah. There is an internal focus to this in terms of the teaching and research. But there is also a very big push towards interfacing externally as well with the outside world and trying to see what IIT Madras can do to help sort of nationally or globally push the sustainability agenda forward.
Absolutely. And what's truly incredible is that you have a very practical outlook to the study, which is what is needed with sustainability. A lot of people study climate change, but what is actually required is the implementation of that study. And what's great is that because this is not just confined to IIT Madras students, we will have more transparency with respect to climate change and sustainability, which is what's missing in the discourse, at least in India, right? So before we actually move on to the curriculum and what exactly would be a part of the course, if we could maybe just understand from you why sustainability, why not climate change, why not the broader theme, global warming, why sustainability?
Well, to us, sustainability actually is the broader theme. I think climate change is one aspect that, of course, interfaces and affects sustainability. And because of changing climates, you have all these kinds of hazards and you've got to adapt to them and mitigate them and so on. But on the other hand, I think we also have to look very closely at things like resource consumption, which is essentially outside of what's happening to the climate. What are we actually doing as industries, as businesses, as government, as individuals? And that relates to what extent are you, for instance, using and recycling water? Things like these, which are not necessarily solely climate-related agendas. So what we want to do, the School of Sustainability, is actually blend both perspectives, the climate perspective as well as the production and consumption perspective. So if you look at our thrust areas, we've got two thrust areas that are probably closer to the climate side. We've got one thrust area on decarbonization, where we have a bunch of people from across departments working on everything from carbon capture to low carbon materials to hydrogen and things like that. And also a bunch of people who are working on modeling, all kinds of artificial intelligence, machine learning, mathematical models, agent-based models, et cetera, trying to sort of see if we can understand the impacts of climate change and what we can do about it. So there are pieces of work that relate more to the climate and carbon agenda. But there are also two other thrusts. One is on what we call human settlements, which is how do we deal with water and waste and so on, when even if the climate were not changing, are very real problems that we would have to deal with. And our fourth thrust, which is really more sociological in nature, is how do we actually affect behavioral change so that we fundamentally revisit the way we consume and produce things? Because all the technology, all the climate models in the world are not going to save us unless we fundamentally change the way in which we sort of go about our daily lives or corporate activities or whatever. So we're sort of 50% split between climate and carbon-driven agendas, and between sort of production, consumption, and sort of human settlement related agendas.
That makes a lot of sense. It seems like an ideal combination. So maybe let's talk a bit more about the curriculum. And how do you see the school encouraging entrepreneurship and the more practical sides of dealing with sustainability?
Yeah. So in terms of the curriculum, right, and this is going to be evolving, like I said, the idea is to give people a base in terms of being able to think about the economics of sustainability. How do you sort of design for sustainability from a systemic perspective, things like that? And how do you sort of take into account, we talk about ESG, but often the E in the ESG is the loudest, right? So yeah. You want to start bringing in the S at the very minimum, and hopefully the S and the G in. So the idea is to give people sort of a horizontal layer of an appreciation of these kinds of things. More mechanically, these would be an appreciation of, techniques like life cycle assessment or, arguments around some of these kinds of areas. But then there will also be these verticals on water, on energy, on buildings, etc. And people can mix and choose. Some people can choose to be generalists. Some people can choose to be specialists and so on. But relevant to your question, the idea is to introduce courses that have a more of a practical component to them. So first of all, new courses that we introduce will be aimed at bringing together faculty from different departments. So it will rarely be one professor from one department teaching a course. It will technically be, for instance, a materials or a metallurgy faculty coming in and teaching a module on mining and extraction of material from the earth. A mechanical engineering faculty then talking about the production process and what you can do there. And then a logistics faculty, perhaps from our management studies department, talking about supply chains and how what was once a metal inside the earth's crust actually then comes to, becomes a product in somebody's home. And, you can look at sustainability across that entire life cycle, taught by different people. So one is to give people more of a holistic view of sustainability rather than just have this one module on sustainable mining, right, which is very focused. Second is to also make this a little bit more project and activity based. So one of the courses that we hope to offer as a required course is really on methodology, right? What are methods in which we can practically test some of these kinds of assumptions that we're sort of making? What are some methods in which you can really rigorously collect data from the ground so that that better informs your product development, right? So that's going to be a critical part of the course. Outside and complementing the course, at IIT Madras, we already have an innovation and entrepreneurship, sort of a pre-incubation system that feeds into our incubator, where students can test out ideas. We give them a little bit of support so that they can think through their business model, so that by the time they graduate, they can decide whether the idea that they have has commercial possibilities. And the plan is also to start a sustainability focused sort of segment in the sort of pre-incubation programs that we already have. So ideally, students would take some of our courses, through those courses and through some of the projects that they do, might come up with ideas, switch into the pre-incubation ecosystem, test them out. Hopefully, by the time they graduate in their final year, they have some clarity. And if what they have seems promising, then they can just jump straight into the incubator and start up, right? So we're trying to sort of see, of course, all of this sounds really good on paper and it has to be implemented and there are challenges, but this is sort of how we're thinking about the curriculum. People need to choose where they want to go. Some people would probably like to go into research And I think that's important that there has to be a place for them. Some would like probably to be generalists and join, you know, maybe join you guys or join a consulting firm, someone who sort of understands sustainability more holistically. But then there will be these people who will sort of be engineers at heart looking to develop products and so on. So we want to make sure that the program balances the needs of these varying communities, but product development and entrepreneurship will be a part of it. And luckily, we already have parts of that ecosystem in place, not for sustainability, but we hope to integrate it in.
Absolutely. And I think one of the key challenges as someone who doesn't come from a technical background, is not an engineer, but has to actually talk about battery technology, motors, on a regular basis when we speak to companies, we actually are not able to fully understand the technology. So how do you see the School of Sustainability at IIT Madras helping people like us, the VCs, who actually have to invest in these companies to help them?
Absolutely. So I think we need to sort of create these offerings, which can loosely be titled climate science for non-scientists or climate science for non-engineers. That's a tagline I borrowed from one of my colleagues, who's a climate scientist who's trying to do exactly this. So I spoke about some of these offerings, online offerings that we're planning to offer for the outside world. At the moment, we're working on a very sort of small 1 month sort of continuing education certificate that we'd like to put out. So in about 20 hours of lecture, can we just quickly cover very high level, you know, both arguments as well as technology trends and directions in a variety of sectors, so that at the very least, we provide non-engineers and scientists or people at a corporate level who may have been engineers once upon a time, but have switched into management with the vocabulary to understand what's going on, right? So that's step one. Step two is then to expand this into a 6 month program. Again, primarily online with sort of a few in-person interfaces in between, which actually leads to a much more rigorous set of certifications, which expands upon this and makes you a little bit of an expert in electrical mobility, in water, in buildings, etc. Beyond that, there will be several thematic offerings, some of which we already have today. We already offer an online program on electric vehicles, which is probably more relevant to people from that industry and so on. So thematically, we will continue to offer these. But the school sort of aims to offer these broader programs aimed at developing a vocabulary, keeping you up to date on trends. At the 20,000 foot perspective, trying to explain the basics of it could be hydrology, it could be the basics of hydrogen, you know, greenhouse gas emissions, so that you've got enough to understand without going into the partial differential equations and the mathematics behind it, sort of understand where people that you're talking to fit into the larger climate science portfolio. And then the last part is perhaps at the CXO level, what we'd like to do is invite people over for a summer or a winter school, which would sort of be an in-house residential kind of program for a week or two, to focus A, on creating these networks, but also on helping people think through business strategy with regards to sustainability. Some of these other offerings will be more technology oriented, but you know, really there is no point in just pushing technology if business strategy and policy do not keep pace. And that is, I think, best done with sort of people at the CXO level who have time to actually come sit. And so that's another kind of offering that we sort of have in mind. So hopefully in a couple of years, all of these will be in place. And literally the idea is that anybody who wants to learn a little bit more about climate change, whatever your background, arts, humanities, investment banking, or even engineers wanting to sort of, you know, I don't know, an aerospace engineer wanting to understand a little bit more about sustainability, should be able to come to IIT Madras, and anywhere between a month to 6 months, there should be an offering that they can, you know, they can sort of leverage and sort of skill themselves or upgrade their level of knowledge in that area.
It sounds great. And maybe once it's up and running, we'll see a lot of our audience members also signing up at some point.
Hopefully. I think our 1 month offering should be up sometime in 2024, the sort of one month online program. So yeah, we'll keep you updated on when it's
perfect. Launched. Perfect. So just moving on to the research part of the school, just a little bit more about how the modeling and the scientific research that's going to be done will support the startup founders in the school and how people are going to actually benefit from the modeling business.
Yeah. So that's actually a good, interesting question. At the moment, you know, I talked about these four thrusts, right? The human settlements, decarbonization, behavioral change, and modeling. At the moment, modeling seems to have the furthest disconnect from startups you know, at the moment. So if you look at decarbonization, there are people working on technologies and, you know, sort of heat transfer, this, that, that very quickly can be productized, or water purification, things like this. Modeling, I think there are still several challenges because, I mean, we're still trying to sort of validate these kinds of models. And unless you can really validate these, actually building companies on this, you know, becomes a little bit of a dicey proposition. So we're actually looking at the modeling piece as being more of a tool to help policy advisory, and not from a deterministic perspective. I mean, we're not going to tell you that this is going to happen and therefore this is what you're going to do. I don't think the science has evolved to that point yet. But what we'd like to do is use it to sort of create a bunch of scenarios and try to see if we can do scenario-based, you know, sort of scenario-based development. So for instance, you've got a city like Chennai that's coming up with its new master plan in the year 2026. So can some of these models and simulations give you scenarios that Chennai could end up at 10, 15 years from now? And based on that, can you sort of decide what should be some of the decisions you need to take today with regards to the master plan? Now, the master planning exercise is complex. The Chennai Metropolitan Development Authority is doing a fantastic job trying to get it together. And in some sense, this was prior to the school, but IIT Madras contributed a little bit in this fashion, trying to develop a few scenarios so that they can then put in these kinds of inputs. So I think from a policy-making perspective, there is probably going to be more takers for the modeling and scenario development piece in the, you know, in the short term. And the other part of the scenario development and modeling piece is to try to see if we can, you know, piece together models at various scales to say something interesting, right? So for instance, you have a colleague of mine is working on this very interesting project where you're looking at, you know, climate change, rising temperatures and sea level rise and flooding of coastal areas and so on, but then also analyzing the impact of that on the loss of language and culture. Because as, for instance, some of the islands in the Sundarbans get, you know, get flooded, people are going to agglomerate in different ways, and that's going to lead to very different lifestyles. There are also people trying to take that kind of modeling input and try to assess what would actually be the property damage in a city like Chennai, and therefore what would be the implications to, say, an insurance company. So we've got these high-level atmospheric aerosol chemistry kind of models, and we've got these very practical on-the-ground kind of models. And I think the idea is to put them together. Policy advisory, I think, is going to be the low-hanging fruit. But for people who can put this together in a very interesting manner, I think there is an opportunity to start up a boutique consulting kind of a firm that can do this kind of interdisciplinary integrated modeling and come up with you know, somewhat prescriptive ideas on what you could do to mitigate climate change.
Absolutely, it makes a lot of sense. But since we're talking about the quantification, maybe if you could tell us a bit more about your views on the monitoring and the MRV side of it. So we've seen a lot of people claiming climate impact, but one of the key problems that we see is that there is no quantification. So at Green Frontier Capital, if you see our portfolio, we encourage our portfolio companies to actually monitor and report their climate impact on a monthly basis to actually see if, as a climate tech company, are you really making a difference? So what are your views on it? How's this?
Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head. I mean, I could go on for hours about this, but you know, what you don't measure, you can't control. And a lot of what I see today in terms of the climate dialogue is very anecdotal, right? So pay a little bit of more money by, you know, for this airline, and I will offset something somewhere. And all of this is just sort of very fuzzy, right? We don't really, you know, let's take something simple. I'm a civil engineer. We build buildings all the time, right? Are we really measuring the amount of emissions both in the construction of the facility as well as in the operations, and then setting benchmarks towards saying, okay, this was the life cycle carbon emission of this particular building. I'm building something similar. Can I reduce it by 20% or 10% or whatever it is, right? Unless you have that kind of measurement benchmarking, you can't improve, right? It's always anecdotal. Yeah, sure, I put solar panels on the roof and I'm now consuming 10% of my energy through solar, but if my entire energy load went up by 2x, then, you know, even 10%, I'm still consuming more from conventional sources, right? So we do very little by way of measurement. So I think measurement and benchmarking are going to be critical going forward. And what's interesting is when you start measuring, you see that there are no sort of standards for measurement. We've just done a little bit of exercise with a couple of my undergraduate students. We have a small house that we took and did a life cycle analysis of that house using a few different approaches and a few different databases and software. Same sort of house, but different approaches. The values we get are hugely different, right? And so depending on, if I want to brag about this particular house, then I'll choose a certain value. If I want to be the person criticizing the house, I can choose another value, right? So again, I think I think we need to start, if we really want to make an impact on the ground, I think we really not need to start first measuring, benchmarking, but then also standardizing this. And then using that to strategically take decisions. I mean, I know we all speak about quantifying scope 1, scope 2, scope 3. But to me, these are all being done very simplistically today. I was speaking to a consultant the other day. Almost everyone seems to say, plant a Miyawaki forest and put solar panels. This seems to be the go-to strategy. Scope 3 emissions is only about the airline miles that you undertake. And I mean, we've sort of narrowed these things down. It's not a bad thing because some of these things are measurable and that's where we should start. But the whole point is we don't measure and we lose sight of the bigger picture. So I think we really, and that's one of the things I'm very passionate about as far as the school is concerned. And it's one of the projects that we've actually started is benchmarking a number of buildings on our own campus with a view towards saying the next building will take input from this benchmarking exercise. And we'll have specific targets that the architect will have to adhere to before we even approve or accept their plan. And then we sort of see how we can implement it. So measurement is critical. We don't do enough about it. We don't do it systematically enough. It's something that we really need to work on. And it's hopefully something that the school will try to push.
We sincerely hope that we actually see some standards coming out of the school in the next few years, not just for buildings, but for electric mobility, batteries, solar, like you mentioned. It's very important. So since we're sort of running out of time, just some concluding remarks on whether you see more schools of sustainability coming up in the country with IIT Madras taking the first step, but any more that you see, and how do you see academia evolving to actually incorporate sustainability in the whole curriculum?
Yeah, I mean, I certainly do see more, whether schools or institutes or departments or centers of sustainability coming up. I mean, everyone may not necessarily feel comfortable with our architecture, but they can have their own architecture. And indeed, they already have. If I recall correctly, IIT Hyderabad, I think, just started a department of sustainability, or the Green Co School of Sustainability, if I recall correctly. So others have done it without renaming themselves as a school of sustainability, but this is sort of going to grow. But to me, I think, and one of the reasons we chose our architecture is going forward a decade from now, just like every student who comes into an IIT Madras has a background in calculus, okay? Every student can do calculus, at least when they come in. Similarly, irrespective of what you are, every student studying at an IIT or an NIT or an IISc should go out with some minimum capabilities in the area of sustainability. So at some point, I think you start by starting this extra department that offers these kinds of courses and so on. But I think going forward, every single course that is taught at a university needs to have a component that relates to sustainability, whether it's a special week of lectures on sustainability connecting to that topic, or whether it permeates the entire course. I mean, that depends on a variety of factors. But that's sort of where I'd like to see academia go, where we don't even talk about sustainability because it's inherent. Right? At IIT Madras, we don't talk about mathematics separately because it's inherent in a lot of what we do. And that's the case in many of the IITs as well as engineering colleges either. So that's sort of one part of what academia needs to do. Second is, we spoke about this earlier in the podcast as well. Can we stop being very inward focused and focusing only on scientific publications, which, by the way, are very important. As an academic, that's my job, is to create knowledge and push it out. But can we also focus a little bit more downstream on implementation and policy advisory? In the US, so I spent 6 years at Stanford, 2 years working there. I saw a lot of this happening at Stanford. And the reason was people felt comfortable coming to an academic institute to discuss this because they felt it was sort of neutral ground, right? This is not an office in government. It's not a private organization. No one's pushing an agenda. And you have experts who are there to sort of discuss. And so some of the most free-flowing discussions I've seen have happened on academic campuses. And I think on the one hand, academia needs to put itself out and say, look, we want to be that platform. But on the other hand, industry bodies, industries, government departments, ministries, I think need to realize that academia can play this role. And probably then sort of even push academia to say, hey, can you guys do a policy dialogue series on something like this? Can you sort of host it, anchor it? things like that. So I think those are steps that academia will need to take in India and abroad. And really, I think we also have to think about this a little bit globally. I don't think at some point, I think we should link beyond India. I think we should think about Southeast Asia. One of our aims is to say, look, there are other countries that may look up to India from an academic perspective, because our universities here are probably a little bit better than the average universities there. So particularly since we're doing some of these things online, can we open them up to places in the eastern coast of Africa, in Southeast Asia, etc.? So can universities also play more of a global role in trying to push sustainability knowledge forward? So these are some of my broad-based teaching across sustainability. So it happens everywhere and not just in silos. Participate more in policy development and practice and implementation in whatever way makes sense. And start globalizing knowledge on sustainability would be my three things on my wish list for what academia should do.
These are absolutely very, very important learnings. And I think the two things that really stood out for me were, one, making sustainability inherent. What you said, absolutely very, very important, which is why I think the School of Sustainability can play a very important role in linking these different courses together. And two is making academic institutions the hub for policy dialogues, because as you said, it's a neutral ground. And we trust our academics. We trust them to not have an agenda. So it's very crucial. So just on a more personal note, since we've talked about the school, we've talked about your journey. What do you think, who are your role models? Who are these people who've helped you evolve your understanding of sustainability? And what are some of your the resource materials that you keep coming back to actually develop your understanding?
Yeah, so from a pure sustainability perspective, all of us have different role models in life. Yeah. And of course, you've got family, parents, all of that. But if you look specifically at sustainability, I think I benefited hugely from my time at Stanford, just because there were a variety of different people who used to walk by. My own PhD advisor's name's Ray Levitt. He's retired from Stanford. He actually is a venture capitalist at the moment. He's a partner with a company called Blackhorn VC. I think sort of was one of the first people who sort of told me about the distinction between the built environment and the natural environment, and how they sort of both come together, and really sort of started me thinking on sustainability. So certainly one, and sort of the way he sort of approached academia was an inspiration, and sort of I've used several of the things I learned from him in my own career, just in terms of being able to think more holistically about this and putting pieces together. There's this person whose book I read 20 years ago, and I had the opportunity to meet for the first time a month ago, a gentleman called Amory Lovins, who is, founded the Rocky Mountain Institute and has done some pioneering work on sustainability. So I would still say, if you're looking at things to read, he had a book about 20 years ago. I just got it autographed a month ago when I met him, this dog-eared copy of a book called Natural Capitalism, which I thought was a fantastic read. As a graduate student, I couldn't put it down, which really sort of drove home the point that you can do better by doing good. Similarly, there was another sort of book that I read at the time called Cradle to Cradle by William McDonough, who was, of course, he was an architect, so it spoke more to me as a civil engineer, but I think it's a book that everyone can read. So I think there are these kinds of seminal books that would be really nice places to start to give yourself a sort of a background on sustainability. And then, of course, there are more thematic things. If you wanted to learn a little bit more about buildings or about electric vehicles or whatever, there are places to look at. But these would be some of my my suggestions on things to sort of think about and books to read. And sort of, of course, there have been several other role models as well. I think we'll go on for another hour if I start naming a lot of them. But I think that point is important to make as well. It hasn't been one or two people who've talked about sustainability. The fact that sustainability has been front and center in multiple discussions has sort of served personally to inspire me towards this. Some people have sort of just given gentle nudges. Maybe they funded a small project. Maybe they gave a little piece of advice. But there's a whole village of people that have been behind my journey in sustainability.
Wonderful to know. And it's been an absolute pleasure speaking to you today. The insights that you brought out will stay with us and the audience, I'm sure, for the long time. Thank you so much for taking out the time to speak with us, Ashwin Mahalingam. We're really looking forward to what the School of Sustainability is going to do in the future.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Ritika, and thanks for having me on this. I greatly enjoyed this as well. Your questions were absolutely fantastic. But thank you so much. And I look forward to staying in touch with all of you as we progress through our sustainability journey.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.